Good evening, everyone. We'd like to welcome you to our service this evening. If you're joining us via the internet, we want to welcome you in the name of Jesus to our service. It's a Sunday, beautiful Sunday evening here in Vancouver on Canada's west coast. We are glad to welcome you to our service. And this is Palm Sunday, and we want to wish you a wonderful day. And coming week is being Holy Week, and may it be a blessing to you. So we pray for you, pray for us. And we're going to continue on now in our service. We're going to sing a couple of songs. We're going to have a message, and then we're going to have the benediction. So God bless you. Welcome. And let's sing a beautiful song called Here I Am to Worship. Would you like to stand? Let's stand. Okay? Let's open our hearts this evening to praise and worship. Lift up your hands and worship. We're called to that. We're called to be worshipers more than anything else is that we worship. And so as we sing this song, join your heart with mine, your voice with mine, and we're going to sing, Here I Am to Worship.
Exalted forever, exalted and high, will be. seated.
Our text tonight is taken from Luke chapter 19, verses 36 to 46. I want to ask you a question as we begin my message this evening. How many of you have ever turned a life-changing moment into a mess by a bad decision or a wrong choice? Okay, there's one, both, two people, three. I think all of us at some point in our lives have turned a life-changing moment into a mess. How often have you heard the statement, you blew it? Or you said to yourself, I've blown this one. How can I mess it up like that? I've said that. How could I have done that? I can't believe I did it. What was I thinking? And I think, from all the smiles and the nods, I think I'm in good company tonight. We've all done it, haven't we? At other times, someone or something comes along to spoil the party. Right? Someone, something, some event, some circumstance has changed everything. Well, I want to use that as a jumping off point for my message this evening. Today is Palm Sunday. We're coming to the close of Palm Sunday. The church around the world has celebrated this momentous occasion and event. Now, if you were raised in Sunday school, how many were raised in Sunday school here? Anybody? You grew up in Sunday school, or you grew up in a Christian family, Christian home, or you went to a church. I think if you have, you would have been very familiar with this narrative tonight, the Palm Sunday celebration. In fact, it was so important that all four Gospels record the account. And it's the recounting of the triumphal entry of the Lord Jesus into Jerusalem. Now, all the times that I've gone to Israel, I've always had the experience of following the steps from the Mount of Olives down through the Kidron Valley and up into Jerusalem to the Temple Mount. And it's always been a very momentous, very emotional experience to consider, to think back that one day Jesus did that. And he presented himself as Israel's Messiah, the long-awaited king who was prophesied to come to the children of Israel. And it was a day of intense anticipation. You see, thousands of pilgrims had come to Jerusalem in preparation for Passover, for Pesach. And in Jewish tradition idea was that the Messiah was going to come. There was this messianic expectation. And so people were sort of hyped up. They were ready and waiting that maybe this year the Messiah would come. So there was an intense anticipation of these thousands and thousands of Jewish people who had come up to Jerusalem. So I hope tonight, for a little while, I want to share with you three thoughts, all right? And I hope that they'll engage our minds and our spirits and help us to orient ourselves to the coming week. This coming week is called Holy Week, or the Passion Week, and it will culminate in the death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus. And so these few thoughts tonight, I hope, will help inspire us and encourage us and orientate our thinking about the coming days. Now, I think I've discovered or I've found some important spiritual truths sprinkled throughout the text tonight, and I want to share with you. And I don't want any of us to miss them, all right? And if you have a chance, or you've got a piece of paper, you might want to write down three tragic events from the triumphal entry. Number one, this was a day of intense celebration and excitement. Large crowds have gathered in Jerusalem with an amazing, rousing welcome. Matthew writes, they were shouting, Hosanna, blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. How many know the word Hosanna? You've heard the word Hosanna. We've sung it tonight, you're familiar with it. What does it mean? Anybody know what Hosanna means? Hoshiana ben David? Hoshiana in Hebrew means save now. Save now, son of David. Hoshiana ben David. And so the thousands of people that had gathered and were coming into the temple area were singing this, Hosanna, Hosanna, blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. And Matthew says in chapter 21 that the whole city of Jerusalem was stirred. It was a cataclysmic event. People were stirred. The city was upset, if you like. They were wondering what on earth is happening with all this crowd and they're singing and praising. But the people were joyfully praising God in loud voices for several reasons. One, for what they had seen that the Messiah had been doing. They had seen his miracles, they had listened to his ministry, but they were praising God in loud voices for the miracles he had done. The children praised him in the temple, shouting the same thing, Hosanna to the Son of David. Children running around the temple courts singing, Hosanna, blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. But there were some, sadly, and I think maybe there's just a few, but there were some who were rebuking Jesus for allowing his followers to say such things. And you know what? Jesus said to them, if they don't praise me, if they don't offer praise and worship, the very stones will cry out. My translation says, even if they kept quiet, the stones along the road would burst into cheers. Do you get the picture? If you don't praise me, if you don't allow them and you prevent people from worshiping and praising me, you know what? The stones along the side of the road will praise me. They will burst into cheer and joy. So the tragedy here, number one, that is in the midst of all of this praise that is going on, there were a group of people, unfortunately they were the religious leaders of all things, who were callously and unwillingly trying to prevent praise and worship. Not only were they unwilling, they even tried to prevent others from doing it. Talk about being spiritually dead. If anyone should have known this day of visitation, it should have been the rabbis, the scholars, the teachers of the Torah. But they were preventing that acts of worship in the city and in the Temple Mount area. Talk about being spiritually dead. Anybody feel spiritually dead sometimes? Spiritually dead? Yeah, I think we all feel that sometimes. Maybe right now you're feeling that. For some reason, maybe you're facing a challenge, maybe you're facing a struggle, you're going through a dark place, maybe you're battling demons, you're unable or even unwilling to praise the Lord this Palm Sunday. Someone said, maybe you're under the circumstances. Have you ever felt under the circumstances in your life? I have. I have over the last year or so been feeling this pressure, this stress, this sort of spiritual sadness in my heart. Discouraged. And there were times when it just didn't feel like I wanted to praise the Lord. I just felt you get to the point where you want to give up, don't you? Yeah, there are people, I think people who are watching by YouTube and by the internet would agree. There are times in lives when you just don't feel like praising. You don't feel like worshiping. Well, I'd like to encourage you tonight to open your heart, to praise the Lord, because Palm Sunday is a day of praise. It's a day of worship. It's the day of the presentation of the Messiah, our King. You know, there's a beautiful prophetic word in Isaiah 61:3. To all who mourn in Zion, this is what the Lord says, I will give beauty for ashes. If you feel like your life is all burnt up and you're just nothing but ashes, He wants to take those ashes and give you beauty. He wants to give you joy. Joy instead of mourning. How many people are tired of mourning? It's just one crisis, one thing after another, and it just goes on and on and on. You know what? I would like a moment of joy. I'd like a moment where I can rejoice and celebrate and thank God. I want that. And He wants to give a garment of praise instead of a spirit of despair. God wants to do that tonight here at Renaissance, I think. Some of us are in despair. Some of us are discouraged. Some of us are mourning. And what we need is to put on a garment of praise and get rid of that spirit of despair. There's power in praise, you know that? There's power in praise. And so as we raise our voice and as we sing Hosanna, something miraculously happens. It releases the power of God into our lives. It brings freedom. It breaks that cycle that cripples and renders us so often powerless. But it's a spiritual discipline to learn to praise. When you don't feel like it, that's the time to praise. When you don't feel like you want to go to church, that's the time to go to church. I don't feel like singing. I just want to sit back and, you know, take it in and not sing. That's the time to pressure yourself, to push yourself to praise and to worship and to sing. And what happens, it releases and it breaks some of that spiritual bondage. That's the power of praise tonight. So whatever your circumstances are, allow praise tonight to rise up in your heart. I was sitting here singing. I could hardly hear anybody singing. I could hear Joel, and I could hear my crackly voice going on, and I'm thinking, who's up there? I didn't want to turn around and see who was singing. But you know what? It's so important that we force ourselves sometimes to open our mouths to sing and to worship and to praise. And you know what happens? It breaks the cycle that has taken you downward. And it can release you, and it can inspire you, and can lift you up. There's power in praise tonight. So the tragedy number one was that there were people who were unwilling to praise the Lord. I don't want to be in that crowd. I want to be, even if I don't feel like it, I open my mouth and I want to begin to praise and to sing. And it breaks something inside of my heart and brings some freedom. Number two, there was the tragedy that the temple had to be cleansed. Now, we all know that the temple in Jerusalem was the center of Jewish worship. It was God's holy sanctuary. It was majestic in appearance. It was beautiful. It should have been the most precious place for God's people. But what Jesus saw there when He entered into Jerusalem, into the Temple Mount, sickened Him. Believe it or not, His heart was broken for what He saw. That hallowed place, that sacred place of worship, had been turned into a marketplace by some unscrupulous vendors. People who were taking advantage of the place that was reserved for Gentile worshipers and trading, exchanging. And what did Jesus do? In His anger and His holy zeal and passion, He had to cleanse the temple. It was His Father's house. He said, "This is my Father's house," and the Spirit of God gave Him such passion for it and such zeal and such chutzpah that He had to do something. He had to respond. Try to imagine the feelings that were going through the mind and heart of Jesus when He saw the corruption in His Father's house. He said, "The zeal of God has consumed me. This is my Father's house." And in holy righteousness and anger, He drove out the vendors. Isaiah 56 verse 7 says, "I want to fill them with joy in my house of prayer." What a beautiful prophecy. What a beautiful statement. I want to give those who come into the house of the Lord, this house of prayer, I want to give them joy. You're not going to find it anywhere else, I'm telling you. You might find happiness, but you're not going to find that deep-seated joy outside the presence of God in your life and when you come together in the house of God. There is something distinctly unique about people gathering together in the house of the Lord to worship and praise. And He wants to fill us tonight with joy. He wants to fill our hearts with praise and thanksgiving for all that He's done. Now, there's an interesting parallel here. Paul, in 1 Corinthians, he says, your bodies are the temple of the Holy Spirit. This is a temple. My body is a temple, a dwelling place, a residence for the presence of God. He said, you don't belong to yourself. God bought you with a high price, so you must honor God with your body. Maybe this evening, it's good to ask ourselves whether our temple needs to be cleansed. Anybody ever thought of, you know, when we come to communion, we often take time to ask for forgiveness and for cleansing so that we would come to the table of the Lord with the right heart and the right spirit. Well, maybe tonight could be one of those moments when we allow the Holy Spirit to search our hearts and reveal anything that needs to be cleansed or corrected or changed or driven out. You know, people, they use cleansing soaps, creams for the skin. You can detoxify and cleanse your inner body systems. But you know what? There's nothing that can cleanse the heart and the spirit except the blood of Jesus Christ. It can cleanse us from all sins. So I want my temple to be clean. I want my heart to be right. I want my heart to be right so that Jesus can dwell in a clean house, a clean home. Do you want that?
Amen.
I think we do. I really believe that there's a point where we are at where we want to be holy, we want to be clean inside, we want to be cleansed. Number three was the tragedy that people didn't recognize God's timing. Biblical prophecy was being fulfilled right before their eyes. Thousands of people were seeing the word of God being fulfilled. Isaiah 62 says, say to the daughter of Zion, that's the children of Israel, say to the children of Israel, see, your Savior comes. He's coming to present himself to you. Zechariah 9:9, see, your king comes to you. He's righteous and having salvation. He's gentle and he's riding on a donkey. That's prophecy 600-700 years before the Messiah came. I love this one, Psalm 118. Please, Lord, Hosanna. Please, Lord, save us. Give us success. Bless the one who comes in the name of the Lord. And so the prophetic word clearly points to him being the Messiah King. He rode a donkey, symbolizing his royalty. Cloaks were spread out on the ground, a way of paying homage to royalty. Palm branches were waved, a sign of victory. Jesus, the Messiah, riding on a donkey, the sign of humility, the sign of a peaceful king, a peaceful leader. So all of these pointed to Messiah. Hundreds and hundreds of years ago, these prophecies were given. But sadly, with all the signs around them, the people didn't seem to get it. Luke 19:44, it says they didn't recognize the time of God's visitation. How sad. They missed it. They had all the signs that were pointing to it. And it happened, and they missed it. And you know what? As a result, he spoke some painful prophetic words himself. I think they're powerful. I think they're shocking. He said, if you, even you, had only known on this day what would bring you peace. Listen to that. If you only knew what would bring you peace, but now it's hidden from your eyes because you did not recognize the time of God's coming to you. So that brings me to a question. I wonder whether it's the same with humanity today. I wonder if that's the same with us today. We're not recognizing the day of God's visitation. All the signs around us are indicative of the coming of the Lord. It's close, but are we seeing them? Probably we don't even know them. But he's coming. He said he would return. There are signs that would indicate his coming. Are we preparing for his coming? Are you interested in his coming? Does it even faze you that he might come? The more I should read my Bible to find out the signs that are coming. But you know what? He is coming. He promised he would come. He would come again. And I don't think a lot of people are preparing. They just sort of stick their head in the sand and say, oh, it'll all pass, and it's not now. We don't know the signs. We don't know what's going on. It behooves us to find out, to live in anticipation that he's coming. I found this scripture in Jeremiah 8:7. It says, even the stork in the sky knows her appointed season, and the dove and the swift and the thrush observe the time of their migration, but my people do not know. How sad, eh? Yeah. The birds know what's going on. They know their migration. They know the appointed seasons, but my people, they're clueless. And the day of visitation is coming, and we need to be prepared. It's sad when it involves the coming of the Lord and God's timing in the affairs of the world. Most people seem to find it difficult to understand or believe what's happening. And so as this Palm Sunday service comes to a close, I'd like to challenge us to learn what's happened that day 2,000 years ago and ensure that we will give praise to the Messiah. I want to be a praiser. I want to be a worshiper, don't you? That my heart will worship freely, uninstructed, unhindered. It will allow our temples to be cleansed. I want my heart to be right. I want my spirit to be right. My thinking to be right. And I want to understand God's timing today. Jesus is coming, and we need to be prepared. The day of visitation is coming. And it's important for us to be aware of the signs of the times that we're living in. Thank God. Thank God for Jesus. Amen?
Amen.
Thank God for our Messiah. Thank God for our salvation. Thank God for our Christian life. And thank God for our future. We have a future. And God is going to guide us and direct us and into a beautiful place where we worship, where we sing, where we serve, where we pray, where we allow our temples to be cleansed daily, where we understand and know his coming. So as we close the service tonight, I'd like us to stand. There's a beautiful passage in Psalm 24, and I often like to read it on Palm Sunday. So would you stand with me? And we're going to read this, and then Joel's going to come and sing an inspiring song, Hosanna. All right, so let's read together. Everybody can see that up there, nice and clear, okay? So read it out loud. I want to hear you tonight as we read together, okay? Let's begin.
Who may climb the mountain of the Lord and enter where he lives?
Who may stand before the Lord?
Only those with pure hands and hearts. Who do not practice dishonesty and lying.
They will receive God's own goodness as their blessing upon him, planted in their lives by God himself, their Savior. These are the ones who are allowed to stand before the Lord and worship the God of Jacob.
Open up, O ancient gates, and let the King of glory in.
Who is this King of glory?
The Lord, strong and mighty, invincible in battle. Yes, open wide the gates and let the King of Glory in. Who is this King of Glory? The Lord Almighty. He is the King of Glory.
And everybody said,
Amen.
Now, please remain standing, all right? Joel's got a preppy song. It's a beautiful one. You can worship as we hear him sing Hosanna.
So God bless each one of you. I close with the English
reminder of the prayer of the blessing. I don't know yet whether I'm going to touch on that next Sunday, being Easter Sunday, where I'm going to go with that yet. But we'll be returning to it in weeks to come, because I still have a lot more to say about the prayer of the blessing. So for now, read with me. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace. And give you shalom.
Shalom.
It's not in there, but I love the expanded version, that little part, and give you shalom. May he give you supernatural health, supernatural peace, welfare, safety, security, soundness, tranquility, prosperity, perfection, fullness, rest, harmony, and the absence of agitation and discord. That's what that last part means, and give you peace. I think those wonderful words. So God bless you. Have a wonderful week. And Joel, back to you for an Amen Corner. God bless you, everyone watching us on YouTube.
This time, Blake is going to do the Amen. Blake?
Amen.
Blake? Are you going to do Amen tonight?